I'm Sabine O'Hare, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences, and host for a new television series we have entitled Causes. The cause driving this television series is you, the residents of the District of Columbia. Over a series of television programs, you will learn about the land-grant tradition of the University of the District of Columbia and the research-based academic programs in nutrition, dietetics, nursing, health education, architecture, and environmental science, and our community outreach programs that seek to improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for the people and communities of the District of Columbia, and by extension, the quality of life for people across the nation and the world. The topic today is one that may stretch our common perceptions and definitions a little bit, the built environment. Typically, when we hear the word environment, we think nature, the outdoors, maybe natural resources like air and water. So what exactly is the built environment, and what does it have to do with our health and well-being and our quality of life? At Causes, we think about this a great deal. After all, the UDC architecture program is a part of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Science. Our architecture colleagues remind us that buildings are an important part of the environment and of environmental health. Buildings can make us sick, or they can make us feel good. They can damage the natural world or be in sync with it and contribute to its beauty and health. With me today are three people who know a great deal about the built environment and its impact. They are Professor Ralph Belton, chair of the architecture program at UDC, and two of his students, Fallon Johnson, a senior and architecture major, and Michael Thomas, a graduate student who also works at UDC's Architectural Research Institute. Welcome, Professor Belton, Michael, and Fallon.
Glad to be here.
Professor Belton, let me start with you.
Okay.
What is this built environment thing about, and what does it have to do with sustainability, agriculture?
It has everything to do with sustainability and agriculture and our food source. We as architects are responsible fundamentally to define the environment in which we live. And you're right. It does make us sick if we don't do it right, and it makes us happy when we do it right. So to us, it's a pleasure being in with agriculture because there are things that are we need to consider as we go forward in the future that has to do with our food source. And because we're tending now towards having fresh foods and vegetables, we cannot get that from many miles away. We need to be able to produce it locally. In the urban environment, we don't have horizontal surface to farm in the same way that we used to do traditionally. It means that our farms are going to go vertical. Here comes the architect, because we now have to figure out how to do that in a densely packed environment, which is the urban scape.
So a lot of design challenges.
A lot of design challenges.
Michael, tell me a little bit of what motivated you to study architecture, to embark on this field.
Well, what motivated me was I lived, raised in Columbia Heights, Washington, D.C., pre-metro, what you see there now today. So I witnessed the transformation of an existing neighborhood into one of the huger metropolis cities of the region, Eastern region, actually. So I come from a background family of engineers and nurses. So after leaving high school, I said, instead of going to engineering, I want to do something fun. I want to do something invigorating. It's something I would love to do for the rest of my life. So sitting on my front porch steps and witnessing across from me all of this transformation going, I said, well, who's responsible for that? And I started digging and asking questions, and architecture. So, you know, so architecture is fused with the arts, it's fused with science, it's fused with so many different elements that I enjoyed, and that, you know, I said, well, this is it. This is what I like to do to create environments, communities to benefit the masses.
So. Interesting, mm-hmm. And I know exactly what you're talking about because my son lives on Girard.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
So I remember that transformation.
Yeah, right, right, yeah,
they've
yeah.
lived there
night
for,
and day.
Yeah,
night
they've
and
lived
day.
There for about going on 7 years now, yes. And so you know exactly like you said, it was before.
Everything
mm-hmm. happened up there, and now it's a great.
It's amazing.
Space.
It's amazing. Yeah. It's amazing. It's amazing. Yeah. Yeah.
I have a four-year-old little grandson, and so he and I we hang out there. You know where the ice cream place is.
Yeah.
Across from the metro. Yes. So, yeah. Right. Well, that's a great story too. You know what caused you to right. turn that to take that path. How about you, Phil?
When I was in seventh grade and we took science, we actually had to do a project where we had to show insulation in a house. Just so happens my teammate's father was an architect. He helped us work on that project. And I was so amazed by the process and how we were able to put this together. I wanted to know how to do it on my own. And I wanted to pursue it at a different level. So my interest started at about 13, and it just grew throughout the years, and it led me into pursuing a career in architecture.
And you haven't regretted it.
Not one bit. Not one bit.
I can see that. And you know, I always say when I go over to the architecture department, there's so much passion. You can just feel it. You know, how much you're really into your field. And it takes a lot. I mean, you all mentioned. You know, there are the sciences. There's mm-hmm. the engineering
yes.
aspect.
Yes.
There certainly is the creativity and the design aspect. How do you go about that whole process? So let's say, you know, you mentioned, you know, this challenge that we're going to be increasingly facing, namely building up in these right. urban spaces where we are used to these wide open cornfields, and that's how right. we think about food production. But all of a sudden we have a very different challenge. Right. So how does one even go about coming up with the ideas?
Well, first of all, as architects, what we need to do is understand or figure out what the problem is. Mm-hmm. So the first step usually in design is that you need to know what the problem is. We call it problem seeking. Mm-hmm. We can't do anything else unless we know what the problem is.
Yeah.
And you cannot assume that you know what the problem is until you do some investigation to figure it out. Now, it's so wide that what I'm going to do is zoom in on one little aspect of the problem. In horizontal farming, one of the reasons we farm horizontally is that we're trying to get as much sun exposure as we can. So if now we're forced to do vertical farming, one of the questions becomes is how do we get the sun to reach the interior of a building or whatever it is so that you can still get the same effect as you would get when you do horizontal farming. So that's one tiny part of the problem. And of course, that one situation forces the building to take on particular shapes depending on how we're going to get the sun in. It's also a management problem. So we're trying to farm vertically. The question then becomes, how do we get from the base to the top? With the people who are going to do the farming, with the goods that is going to come out from that farm. Don't think the farming is just about vegetables and legumes or something like that. It also means that we're going to have fish farming, mm-hmm. which now involves water. The question is, where do we put this tank? How do we handle? So it's a myriad number of questions that we need to answer on the technical side. Mm-hmm. On the art side, and this is about the happy part of it, how do we create an environment that is pleasing and pleasant mm-hmm. to the user, that makes it easy for the user to move back and forth and it's not a burden? So that's the sort of art side, because now we need to sort of flip hats from the technical to the visual perception of what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And I'm really fascinated by trying to figure out how that's going to manifest itself.
Yeah. Interesting. So that link between the aesthetic right. and the functional,
exactly.
right?
Exactly.
Fallon, you mentioned, you know, your first experience with working on this project. One of the things that I'm always intrigued by when I walk over to your space in the architecture department is all the models.
Oh, yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Depending on the project, you will complete a scaled model to go along with your project. Like in Mr. Pearson's current senior studio, we will be doing models of our schools of nursing for this semester. And according to whatever requested by your professor, the scale, that's how we develop the model, which is the fun part. Yes. That's where the art comes in, because we focus on technical, but as you develop your model, you get to play around with the aesthetics of your building. And that's how you really create that certain something that makes your building different from everyone else's.
What are some of the materials you use to build these?
There are so many. We have different types of wood you can use to do your models, as well as a styrofoam board that can be used. You have a lot of options. It really depends on what you want your model to look like aesthetically, and that determines what different materials you use to give it the look you need. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So you really need to be a little bit of a carpenter, too?
Yes! Yeah. I've definitely cut my fingers a few times.
Depending on what you're working on.
Yes.
Architecture is that kind of profession. It means you have to have a knowledge about a vast number of things. And this is one of the things that really attracted me to be an architect. Mm-hmm. To tell you, they spoke a little bit about how they came to architecture. One of the subjects that I liked was physics. Mm-hmm. A very avid physics person. I almost became a physicist, in fact. And only to discover that I wanted to have a broader a knowledge base, because I also liked mathematics and I liked history and mm-hmm. I could draw well and artistic sculpture and all these kinds of things. The only profession that seems to allow me to engage all of these things is architecture. Mm-hmm. So I get to use all my physics knowledge, I get to use all my biology knowledge, mm-hmm. I get to use my artistic skills. You name it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As an architect, we have to know something about all of those things. Even human behavior, for example.
Yes.
Many years ago, I listened to a lecture from an industrial psychologist, and I think you spoke to him the other day, Dr. Nichols.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering why my mentors wanted us to hear this lecture from a psychologist, and an industrial psychologist, no less, only to discover that the things that we do in the environment influence the way people behave, and the other way around too. Mm-hmm. So we need to have that kind of knowledge to be able to design a proper environment. The color of the walls in a hospital seems like a small item, mm-hmm. but trust me, if you can pick the wrong color and totally make someone unwell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it takes that kind of depth of knowledge.
Interesting. Yes. So you may be one of the few remaining true Renaissance fields.
Exactly.
Right? Where you can bring all those different
exactly.
things together. Michael, you mentioned your family background in engineering and nursing. Mm-hmm. Is there any connection for you personally between your chosen field of architecture and health?
Well, yes. Not necessarily, I guess, conscious, but mm-hmm. Subconscious in a way, because the main fact that we have engineers and nursing is this thing whereas you have the concept to take care of people or to provide mm-hmm. a better environment for a person. You know, engineering-wise, as a computer engineering side, but with engineering in high school at Wilson, I was in the National Society of Black Engineers, NSBE, in the pre-collegiate mm-hmm. chapter. So I went to a convention, and that's what kind of opened my eyes more so to the building side of engineering.
Mm-hmm.
So. Mm-hmm. With that being said, I guess the need to secure a habitable environment or health-wise or building-wise for the masses and incorporate the artistic, the aesthetics, and the human behavior of how city functions, how their lifestyles function. I guess all that is infused also in a way. And like Professor Belton said, I guess to broaden the knowledge and have an understanding of why things are the way they are and mm-hmm. who shapes the world that we're living in our in our region or in our neighborhood, from a macro scale to a micro scale. So
mm-hmm.
that's the passion that I think doesn't die out, because yeah. we have to provide that for not only ourselves but our children and our children's children and show them the importance and make sure they understand the importance so that they can continue along this this venture that we're seeking out mm-hmm. to provide. So
yes. mm-hmm. One of the things that I always find sort of intriguing. It seems to me that a lot of times when you are practicing architect, you may have one building here, one building there, and so forth. How do you actually begin then to influence a whole neighborhood or a community? How does that work?
Well, there's another aspect to architecture, and I hope that as our program grows that we're able to add those things. And there's a whole separate specialty, planning, that deals with the issues of the entire urban scape, and especially along the lines of policy planning, because someone has to set the rules up by which we do these urban scapes. And if the rules are not right, the urban scape gets chaotic and doesn't work, et cetera. So hopefully, as we expand our architectural program, we can expand into looking at urban planning, the urban planning aspect.
I can see so many links here, also to infrastructure, transportation, all of that.
That's right.
Fallon, if you look at your course of study, you're a senior now in the program. So does anything stand out, any favorites among this wide variety of things that you've been able to explore in the program?
I can't say. I enjoy studio the most. I must say that. Doing art electives, I feel, helps me expand on the artistic part of my architecture, which also plays a major part in how you design aesthetically. I feel like I'm blessed to be in a program where I've enjoyed the journey. A lot of people do not enjoy school, but I feel you succeed more and you go further when you actually enjoy what you're doing. So I'm all around happy. Like, I enjoy coming to work and I enjoy going to class, and that's a true blessing in itself.
That's great.
And as a teacher, I'm so glad to hear that.
Warms our hearts as teachers, right, when we hear that.
Teaching is in a way a difficult profession. You know, I always say that, why is it that, I'm able to give away everything I know to someone else when the approach should be, I'm capitalistic about it. I want to keep it to myself because I can make a lot of money. But here I am for the last 30 years just giving it away.
Yeah.
And this is what makes it precious to me, that someone else can really enjoy it, take it and do something even better with it.
That's a wonderful than
I gift. Could. Yes.
That's a wonderful gift. Michael, you work in the Architectural Research Institute, which is, we call it one of our land grant centers within the College of Architecture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Science. But tell us a little bit about that.
The working at ARI, working in a practical environment where you're actually getting a chance to utilize the knowledge that you learn in studio or from school in a real world environment kind of helps you understand how these things correlate, and it makes you get the most out of the knowledge. Because if you're using the knowledge but you don't have the means to practice, what good is the knowledge? Mm-hmm. So the fact that ARI is there and you have that arm, it enhances everything that we're being taught, enhances all of our experiences. It gives us a chance to interact with not only the academia side, but with also the community itself, the users, the end users, the people who we're doing this for. It gives us a chance to allow to listen and hear their comments, their concerns, and allows us to actually have a chance to do something about that. So that experience in ARI, and also with the other land grant programs underneath Causes, I think that's one of the things that students, if more students had the chance to be in those programs, they would get it. They would see why what is in them learning is so effective, why there's needs. There has to be people who has to do this because, they see it. With the watershed program, they're doing work at the Anacostia.
Yeah.
They're there almost weekly, and, you get to see how we must combat the climate, that was the changes that are here or are coming. So being at ARI definitely added a lot. I guess the passion, eggs on the passion, it feeds the passion even more so. So Causes is on a
So you think we've got a good idea here?
Yes.
Absolutely. Linking the classroom to the real world environment.
Right. Yes. We have a very unique idea. I think the only other place that comes close to what we do at the Architectural Research Institute is the Boston Architectural Center, but that's a graduate level operation. But we definitely have a unique program here. There are actually people who are jealous of it, wish they can do it. A couple of other universities tried, but they haven't quite been able to do it. But because architecture is a profession that's so grounded in the reality of what people are doing in the communities, the Architectural Research Institute allows us that opportunity to interact directly with the client and to hear the real story, not some made up thing for the studio classroom that's clinicized, but a real problem. You know, the toilet doesn't work right. I don't have a bathroom or a kitchen in a location that I needed. How do I solve that? So it's all real problems with real people with limited budget most of the time, trying to better their environment. And that's what architects do. We try to figure out how to make a better environment for people.
What projects are you working on right now, Michael? Any specific location in the district?
Currently working on single-family residences within the District of Columbia. That is our main focus with urban sustainability. So how do we handle these things that, once again, I've said in the micro scale, you know, we have to handle that first before we start to become grander in our approaches, I guess I would say. So right now, just single-family dwellings in Washington, D.C., and currently working on my thesis. I'm in graduate school, so I'm busy. I'm
quite so you're a busy guy.
Quite engaged.
Who's doing the multifamily stuff?
The multifamily pad. Property acquisition.
But we do limited multifamily, so small scale commercial, so small apartment buildings.
Right, 4-unit.
Yeah, buildings. And a new construction for single family homes falls under pad.
And the nursing building that you mentioned
is our senior
here on campus for your senior project. Okay, so you have to actually fit it into a real existing space and make it work
And that's the interesting part. And to develop the building, and we also have to develop the site to show how the building fits in its context. So it's very interesting to see. It's even more interesting to see when you draw something, to see it develop. So like when it comes to single family and pad, as we work on projects in the office, when you go out to visit and do site visits and you see as the project comes along and development of it, it puts everything together. It makes it make sense.
That's the greatest feeling of architecture, something you design.
The greatest pleasure I had was when I my first design got built. I couldn't stop walking by the place. I drew this, and it's a reality,
So you actually have to sort of hang out in that space too, right? To get a feel for it.
Yes,
I would imagine. Okay, well, that's great.
It is.
So taking input of the natural environment where that building is actually going to go.
Yes.
So that's an important part of the assignment as well. Okay. Well, I think we obviously this is a huge, huge topic, right? And we've just barely touched it. On a lot of these issues that we could expand on. So I think maybe at some point you all are going to have to come back, and we're going to have to pick some other aspects.
Exactly. We didn't get to talk much about the sort of future-looking aspect of this, and this is a big piece. This is one of the reasons why I totally enjoy being in the college with agriculture and the food science people and environmental science people, because it's a wide open field with a lot of opportunities and potential. And I'd like to spend some time talking about that and getting the word out as to what it really means to have causes and what its impact is going to be on DC to start with and the wider world.
And of course, we have huge opportunities here in DC with Mayor Gray's Sustainable DC initiative that really links to a lot of the topic that you mentioned, both in terms of energy and resources, mm-hmm. the aesthetics of a space, mm-hmm. and how a space contributes to human community, exactly. too, mm-hmm. right? We can either isolate ourselves,
yes.
right? Or we can really create an environment that's more conducive
yes.
to human community. Mm-hmm. So, well, and you know, a lot of these topics that we've just scratched on, we'll definitely have to pick up on
yes.
again.
Definitely.
You all, please, all the best with your project.
Thank you very much.
And I would like to thank my guests, Professor Ralph Belton, Fallon
thank
Johnson,
you.
And Michael Thomas from the Department of Architecture at the University of the District of Columbia. And I thank you for joining me for Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. We are dedicated to improving the quality of life and economic opportunity for people and communities in the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.causes.edu. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time.